In Unreal Engine 5.3, to start using the path tracing feature, you want to go up to the Edit, Project Settings, search in Ray for ray tracing or whatever, right? And then you scroll down here and you want to make sure that the support hardware ray tracing is checked as well as the path tracing checked right here. Once you have that set, once those are checked, then the path tracing option will be enabled right here. Now you may have to restart the editor and have to compile shaders with that, but after that, then you're all set. Then you want to make sure that you have a post-process volume right here that kind of surrounds the scene or kind of fills the scene, right? And in order to create that, if you haven't already, go to the create icon right here. You go to the visual effects and post-process volume. Then you create that, you scale it up, and you're ready to go. So I'm going to jump to my camera right here. I made a short sequence right here of just, you know, a few still shots. So in the outliner, select the post-process volume. You want to scroll down to the path tracing section in the post-process volume. Let me talk to you about most of these settings. The max bounces is the amount of times light bounces off a surface to hit another surface. And so if I go to lit, path tracing, you can see that the lighting is kind of slightly changed, but it's doing a more progressive render because it's the actual more accurate ray traced render that Unreal Engine supports, right? So as this is rendering, as you can see, this is the progress bar here. Once this completes, that's kind of like the rendered image, right? So if I set the max bounces to 0, no light is bouncing in the scene, right? If I set this to 1, light will come in, but it will not bounce off of the floor onto the ceiling or, you know, other kind of surfaces. So if I set this to 2, then you can see it bounces up and, you know, bounces kind of in more places, allowing for more kind of that indirect global illumination kind of lighting effect, right? Now, if I set this to 3 and 4, the changes may be a little bit subtle, depending on which scene you have, but you can see that the light bounces more and has a more realistic, you know, final result here. The samples per pixel, so lower number means less quality and noisy renders, but renders fast. Higher number equals better quality, less noise, but longer render times. If I set this number to, let's say, 100, it's going to render, as you can see, much faster. Because it's rendering so quickly, the quality might be a little more muddy, more kind of noisy, that kind of stuff, right? If I set this to like 1, you can kind of, you know, maybe see it's kind of really getting a little, you know, just especially in here, like you can kind of tell like the lower quality. If you set this to something like 2000, as you can see, it takes a lot longer, but it renders with, you know, better quality and less noise. I'll put this back down to 300. So now for the max path exposure, I like to think of this setting as the amount of glow from surface highlights, lights, and emissive materials. A higher number means like more glow. Sometimes can look like it's sparkling, especially in like a car paint material. Lower number equals less glow. So as you can see, there's a lot of kind of glow under like the cabinets right here, and especially in the ceiling light right here, right? If I turn this down to like 0, as you can see, there's much less glow, and this is a much kind of softer light. From my experience with testing in UE 5.3, max path exposure does not affect the render times. With certain materials and specular highlights, it can have some artifacting and some different kind of like, you know, flickering kind of going on there. And then skipping down to here, which is the denoiser, this basically just denoises the image, right? So if this is, you know, checked here, and then if I uncheck it, as you can see, there's just a little bit of like that noise, that grain in the render. And so what the denoiser does, it just kind of tries its best to clean that up to, you know, to kind of have it look, you know, much cleaner. Depth of field will also show in the render if your cine camera actor has it enabled. So here I have a sequence right here with the cine camera actor. As you can see, I have depth of field enabled. If I go to that camera actor, if I go to the focus settings, I can see the focus is manual at 35 distance, right? So it's focusing on this mug, right? So when you're ready to render your sequence, open up the movie render queue, and then you go into the settings. For the rendering, I have a path tracer setting right here. All of these are, by the way, in the settings right here as well. I do not have the deferred rendering because I don't want it to render the standard way. I want it to render with the path tracer. I have the anti-aliasing in this. This is very important. In the spatial sample count, you want to set this number to the number of your max samples per pixel. This is kind of like your render quality. Then you also want to see override anti-aliasing. You want to have that checked. So then if you hit accept, render local, then it will start rendering that. It'll go a little bit slower because it has to render that amount of frames. It's kind of how you render out with path tracing in Unreal Engine 5.3. Let me know if you have any questions or concerns. Subscribe and like, and thanks for watching.